Yeah, you can take it with me.
Oh, really? Okay. All right. Thanks. Setup-wise, hopefully you're up and running with IPython and the notebooks. This is the GitHub repository where everything's located, including the setup information. My assistant here is Brian Granger. Definitely the best assistant you could possibly have for something like this. So flag him down if you have any technical issues. Any questions about kind of the setup based on the README file and all that? Are we all good to go there? Yeah. Oh, yeah, thank you. Yeah, I would do a git pull. Nothing major. I just can't help myself. I keep tweaking things. So it's mostly just typos and things that I was going over this morning. So if for some reason you can't, don't worry about it. But if you can, just do a pull. It's this guy here. So my GitHub account and then scipy2014_tutorial. And let's see. Yeah, so here it is here. If there's some interactive parts to this tutorial, but if you don't want to, you can just look at the IPyMB files under the using the IPython viewer if you want, and Brian can help you with that if need be. So it's nice to have this little open in NB viewer clicker here. So you can just view them this way, but hopefully you'll do some interactive stuff here with me. Any other questions? Okay, so So this is kind of what I've got for you today. I think it's about right in terms of content. It's not quite as ambitious as my outline was, but I think it's going to be good. Let me start by asking, are there any card-carrying statisticians in the audience? How many statisticians? How about data scientists? Some data scientists. How many engineers/computer scientists? How many are something else? Compliment. Oh, all right. So the idea here is it's going to be an introductory Bayesian statistical computing course. I'm not going to make very many assumptions about what you know. I think I said on the intro material that you should have taken some stats class as an undergraduate or a graduate, which is I think a pretty low bar if we're scientists. Most of the stuff they taught you was wrong. You'll find that out today, but that's okay. And so so the first part, I'm going to give an introduction to Bayesian analysis, and this is going to be a little bit more didactic, I guess, than we like. Okay, the SciPy tutorials pride themselves on being interactive and so on and so forth, and we're going to get there, but I think I just need to talk about Bayes a little bit. And how fast we get through that will depend on you. If you want me to slow down and explain things, definitely ask questions. But if this is easy and we've all seen it before, then we can kind of move past it. I just want to give everybody kind of a common baseline so that the thing isn't a complete black box when we get into PyMC and MCMC and all that kind of stuff. Okay. And then I'll get into Markov chain Monte Carlo, which is the main computational tool for doing Bayes these days. And first I'll look at it with kind of the curtain open and not even use PyMC, but we'll be using just SciPy, NumPy kind of stuff and kind of building things from scratch a little bit just to do it once, just so you know what it's doing, because this can be very black boxy and you kind of want it to be black boxy when you're doing it day to day, but it's important to know what things are doing. And then we'll talk about PyMC and how to build a couple models in PyMC, and then look at model checking and evaluation and those sorts of good things. Okay. Any questions about the content here? Yeah, feel free to interrupt me at any time with questions or problems. So I'm gonna talk about a little theory, and I do mean a little. This isn't a math class. This isn't even a a theoretical stats class, but it's good to be able to understand a little bit about what's going on when you're applying Bayesian methods. And all too often, what we get taught in statistics classes, particularly for non-statisticians, are just the methods with very little, if any, theory. And so you go away not really understanding what you've done, and you're only able to apply it to very kind of textbooky sorts of examples and not real-world examples. And so I think a little theory goes a long way in that respect. So let's start at the beginning. What is Bayesian analysis? You usually don't get, how many have taken a Bayesian stats class before? Look at that, two? Some people half rose hands, okay, so a couple half courses. It doesn't get taught very much, even today. And there's a few reasons why that's done. A lot of it now is just inertia. Okay, statistics curricula have been set 30 years ago, and they don't tend to change very much. But Bayesian statistics isn't just kind of a method. Okay, it's not a particular method for doing statistics, although it's taught that way, right? You get most curricula, it's kind of you got your regression courses and your ANOVA courses and your measure theory courses, and then there's a Bayes course over here, as if it was just kind of another regression tool. It's an alternative paradigm for doing statistics. So everything you do in a stats class, in a classical statistics class, you can do as a Bayesian. They have their methods for doing the same types of methods. So it's a different way of looking at things. And if we look at one of the good references, and up here these pictures of books are, given that I'm not going to teach a full Bayesian statistics class here today, it's always good to have some good references. Those are three that I like. In particular, Bayesian data analysis by Gilman et al. Is kind of the Bible. If you want to pick up one, that's probably a good one. A new edition just came out. But their definition is this, practical methods for making inferences from data using probability models for quantities we observe and about which we wish to learn. So the idea is you've got data you've collected, and you've got stuff that you're trying to learn something about, and how do you make that work? You use probability models. One of the features of Bayesian analysis is that all the conclusions from any sort of Bayesian analysis are stated in the form of probability statements. So we've got some probability of something that's unknown that we want to know about, a population parameter perhaps. And the general notation is, we're using a Greek symbol for unknown parameters. And then this bar here is a conditioning line. And on the other side are things we've observed. Okay. So given some stuff we've observed, what do we know about these theta things? And this use of probability models actually benefits us all once we learn how to use it. It makes things really easy to interpret, which is a big bonus because we're often sharing our conclusions with people who aren't statisticians and aren't even technical in any way. It's easy to incorporate uncertainty about your system. It's easy to calculate summary statistics and so on. So once you get it working, it's really, really nice to be able to do things this way. So what's the difference between Bayesian and classical, or what we call them, frequentist statistics? And this traditionally has been a big can of worms. Okay? Statisticians at enormous national meetings used to fight openly. Okay? They'd have different kickball teams and stuff like that. And they didn't associate with one another. If you want to know a little bit more about this, Jake Vanderplas has a talk on Tuesday that will go into a little bit of detail about the difference between Bayes and frequentists. But the idea is this, is that irrespective of what kickball team you play for, you have sort of three important quantities as a statistician that you're worried about. One is something that you're interested in, right? Some unknown quantity. Why are we even working out this problem? There's something unknown that we want to estimate or test or so on. And we can loosely call these parameters. Those are those thetas I was just talking about. And so we go out and collect some data, right, that might contain some information about the unknown things that we just talked about in number one. And then third is we have some sort of model. And the model connects the data to our unknown and somehow transfers that information. So irrespective of what kind of statistician you are, you have these components. Now, if you're a frequentist, This picture here is of a famous frequentist. It's not Santa Claus checking his list. This is R.A. Fisher, so he's one of the great classical statisticians. If you're a frequentist like R.A. Fisher, what you believe is this. Your view of the world is this. The data that you've just collected are considered random quantities. They're random. They're random because they came from random processes out in the world that you've gone to observe. Every time you go out and observe that system, you'll get different numbers, hence random. The model parameters, the things that you're interested in, however, are fixed. They're unknown and fixed, and so we condition on them. And so a frequentist model kind of takes this form here, f of y given theta. So y is the, if you like, computer science standpoint, you know, are the arguments of your function. And then theta are fixed. They don't change every time you call that function. Okay. So it takes our data as the argument conditional on the parameters that we don't know the value of. And so if you're a frequentist statistician, what you do is you sit around and you come up with estimators for things. So if I want to know the mean, you know, what's the prevalence of diabetes in Austin, Texas, I would come up with an estimator for that that allow me to estimate that quantity based on the data that we've observed. And we pick those estimators based on some criterion, right? We might want it to be unbiased, for example, or we might want it to have as low a variance as possible, or we want it to be efficient, so that we use as much of the information in our data as we can. And so the simplest example here is estimation of a proportion as a frequentist. And so let's say we've collected information about autism and how prevalent autism is in a population. So you go out and you ask individuals somehow whether they have autism or not. And so we have Y individuals that have been diagnosed with autism and then N total people that you queried. And it turns out that the frequentist estimator for that prevalence is just Y over N. So P hat means an estimator of P. And why this particular function? It makes intuitive sense, but it turns out that this is an unbiased minimum variance estimator. So it's got good properties. Okay. A key thing, though, is that anytime you have a new problem with a new unknown quantity, you've got to go out and come up with a new estimator for it. Estimators are problem specific. How about Bayesians? What do Bayesians do? Well, Bayesians look at things exactly the opposite from a frequentist. To a Bayesian, the data are fixed. Okay? Once you've collected your data, it doesn't change. Right? You write it down in your little lab notebook or your IPython notebook, and you open it up the next day, and it doesn't change. Okay? If you put it in Excel, it might change, but that's a different problem. Okay? It's fixed. They used to be random, but they're not random anymore. Okay? So it's fixed. Model parameters, on the other hand, well, okay, they may be fixed, but what we're going to do is we're going to consider them random and use a probability distribution to describe the uncertainty in that value. Okay? So we're going to use probability in a slightly different way. We're not saying that it's a random outcome. We're saying that we can use a probability distribution to describe how much we know about that parameter. Okay? And so this implies a different model, P of theta given Y. So now Y is fixed, got the data in our hand, it's not changing. Theta is not going to change, but our knowledge about it will change depending on what the information that's in Y. Okay. So everybody get that distinction? In fact, Bayesianism used to be called inverse probability because it's inferring from observations to parameters or from effects to causes. You observe the effects and you try to infer back to the causes. Bayesians don't need a new estimator for every problem they have. They only use one estimator. It's called Bayes' formula. We'll get to that in just a second. So following Gell-Mann again, he kind of breaks the whole business of doing Bayesian data analysis into three steps, and I think it's a very good generalization. And so the three steps are as follows. The first step is you specify a full probability model. So we said the Bayesian analysis is about using probability models to learn about things we care about. And so what we have to do is come up with this. We got to write down this model completely. Everything that is influential on the system that you're trying to make inferences about, you have to include. So how the data has been generated, what the unknown parameters are, if there are any covariates that might help predict things, missing data, those sorts of things. And so you have to assign all of these quantities probabilities. So what's the sampling distribution look like? What describes our uncertainty and the unknown parameters? And we'll get into this in just a sec. So you just got to write it down. We may not be able to solve it yet, but we can at least write it down, right? Then the next thing we do is we calculate a posterior distribution. So what does posterior mean? Posterior means later in time or subsequent, according to the dictionary definition that we're interested in. Why is it posterior? It's because it's going to tell us what we know about the unknown after we've observed the data. And so the posterior distribution is what we're going to formulate in our probability model from up above. So we can always write it down, but we can't often calculate it analytically. Very rarely can we. And in fact, that's one of the things that's made Bayesian statistics very difficult for folks to use, or it had been until the computing technology had caught up with the methods that are used to calculate posterior distributions. So that's been one of the problems. Once you've got that posterior distribution, you get a lot of stuff automatically. Okay, you can get point estimates for things, you can get probability intervals, you can make predictions, and so on. So somehow we've got to get a calculated posterior. And then the third step is very, very important, and you can argue that this is important irrespective of what school of statistics that you subscribe to, and that is check your model. It's very critical as a Bayesian because the model is all you've got. Classical statistics is a little bit more robust in that respect in that it can be so much is dependent there on the design of the experiment or the design of the study and a little bit less so on the form of the model. But we really have to look hard at it because the model is all we've got as Bayesians. Does the model fit the data? Are the conclusions from your model reasonable? If whatever numerical method you used to get a posterior distribution, did it work? Did it converge? All of these things need to be checked. If you change your model structure, how much does it change your conclusions? So this warrants its own step. It's that important. Any questions about that? Very sort of 10,000 feet view of that, but that's all you have to do to be a Bayesian. There's a lot hidden underneath each of those, but particularly the second one. So we've done the what. Now what about the why? Why go through all of this problem, all of this trouble when we have a perfectly useful classical paradigm? Bayesian methods are, as it turns out, extremely useful and extremely flexible. I wasn't trained as a statistician originally. I'm a biologist, and I started building Bayesian models because I just couldn't answer the questions that I needed answered any other way. They're super flexible, super easy, very, very pragmatic. Lincoln Barker, who wrote another good book on Bayesian methods, says that Bayesian approach is attractive because it's useful. It's useful because it's simple. And that simplicity allows us actually to build more complex models because it's built on these sort of very basic building blocks. And by that simplicity, I mean, we've got one estimator. We've got one formula that we're interested in. We're using probabilities to describe everything. And so everything is kind of unified. Related to that, it's coherence, treating all of our unknown quantities as probabilities. They're all estimated in the same way. And so it's very, very useful in that sense. And then also, and this is important as well, the interpretability of the outputs of Bayesian methods tends to be a lot higher than that of classical statistics. It's just easy. Folks know, although probabilities get misinterpreted by the public, folks generally know, can have an intuition about probabilities in the way that you don't sometimes don't about other statistical quantities. And here's a good example, and this kind of, I think, highlights the difference between the two schools. So How many folks know what a confidence interval is? Almost everybody. So this would have been covered in any statistics class that you might have taken. So confidence interval attempts to quantify the uncertainty in a particular estimate. And it's based on the assumptions about the sampling distribution of the data. It's a frequentist metric. And so the idea, you know, you'll get these in scientific papers. You get 95% usually confidence intervals. Okay? And this is what the expression for a 95% confidence interval is. It says the probability of of theta being between A of Y and B of Y given theta is 0.95. Most of the civilized world interprets this interval incorrectly. Okay? The incorrect interpretation that most people assume that it is that there's a 95% chance the true value is between those two points. That is not how you interpret a confidence interval. Remember, if you're a frequentist, theta is fixed. Okay? It's either inside that interval or it's not, with probability 0 or 1. There's no probability about where it is. Okay? We're conditioning on theta. The random things here are A of Y and B of Y, because our data is random, right? And so this is how we calculate it. And really, the interpretation of that interval is based on repeated theoretical repetitions of the experiment that you've done. So a 95% confidence interval says if your experiment were repeated an infinite number of times and you calculated an interval for each of those experiments, 95% of those intervals would contain theta. That's not the same thing, and it's not easy to describe to people. And even after you do describe it to them, they'll still go off and misinterpret it. It's like, all right, nerd, I know what you're talking about. Just give me my interval. I got to publish my paper. It doesn't really sink in a lot of the time. They can be the same thing. They can mean the same thing in certain situations, but in general, it's not true. Okay. So this is the notion of a confidence interval. It's not really a probability interval. A probability interval looks like this. Probability of A of Y is less than theta, less than B of Y, now conditional on the data, is 95%. Now, because we're conditioning on our data and we're considering theta to be random, we can interpret this interval as there's a 95% chance theta is between A and B. And that's really what we want, right? That's what we want to know. I made a mistake here. The credible interval. So Bayesians tend to call these things credible intervals. They're just probability intervals. It's a statement about what we know about theta given our particular data set. Okay? In the frequentist world with confidence intervals, it depends as much on an infinite number of experiments that we've never done as it does about our data. A lot of it has to do with the design of the experiment. Okay. Any questions about that? Don't even ask about p-values. I'm not even going to get into it. So it's worth then, because probability plays such a huge role in Bayesian statistics, it's worth spending a little time talking about probability, given that most of you have probably not taken a probability course. And you may not know that there are several types of probability. And the first two you've probably considered before. The third, perhaps, not. And so the first definition is what is commonly known as classical probability. And classical probability is an assessment of possible outcomes, outcomes of elementary events. So this is based on examining the system that you're about to study. So let's take a genetic example. So let's say that we're trying to estimate the proportion of female births in a population. If we're using classical probability to estimate the probability of a female birth, you would dig into the genetic literature, right? And you'd say, well, sex is determined by sex chromosomes, and if there's an X and a Y, it's a male, and if it's two X's, it's a female. And because a male and a female makes a child, then there's a 50% chance of getting the X chromosome from your father versus the Y chromosome. And so that would be classical probability, right? So the number of X outcomes is 1, number of possible outcomes is 2.5. Right? Didn't have to observe any births, didn't have to know, didn't have to go in the hospital, in the maternity ward, didn't have to do any of that stuff. These elementary events are assumed to be equally likely, which is kind of circular in a definition of probability, but never mind that. Frequentist probability, the other kind, is a more empirical approach. Well, how many female births in a population? Let's go to the hospital and count them up. Okay? Observe 1,000 births and see how many of them are female. Don't have to know anything about genetics. Okay? One of the first real-world applications of Bayesian inference was Laplace in the 18th century trying to actually estimate that very quantity by observing births in Paris. So, and he observed, you know, 500,000 births and did things this way. So this is just an objective statement about things that have occurred. Okay? Same thing with a coin. You could look at the coin and observe heads and tails, or you could just flip coins, right? There's a third probability that doesn't really apply to either of those situations, and that is probability as a measure of uncertainty in the value of something. And these are probabilities we sometimes talk about and care about, but they're not necessarily either classical or frequentist. For example, the example I gave before, what if we want to know the prevalence of diabetes in Austin? Well, there aren't an infinite number of Austins to go visit and see how many people have diabetes in them. I guess if you knew a lot about the disease and the genetics, you could do kind of a classical approach, but it's essentially describing uncertainty and an unknown value. What's the blood type of the person sitting next to you? Well, that person knows what it is, so there's no uncertainty for them, but you don't know. There's only one of that person, so you can't kind of do it frequentistly. What's the probability that, a sports example, the Nashville Predators winning the Stanley Cup next year? What's the probability it's raining in Nashville right now? Okay. These aren't long-term frequencies of events. This is just something that's unknown that you care about, that you're describing based on probability. Or the World Cup, you get every time somebody scores the World Cup, you get updated win probabilities. What do those mean? Those are subjective probabilities. Okay. These are epistemic probabilities that describe our uncertainty in things. So that's what probability is. What we do as Bayesians is the way that we apply this probability is we ascribe a particular statistical, usually parametric form on each of these unknown and known. So our data gets a probability distribution, our unknowns get probability distributions. And so the one good tool in your toolkit as a Bayesian should be relative familiarity with your probability distributions. It's good having a nice textbook that shows you all of your probability distributions or some sort of reference because you use them for everything. And so I'm just going to kind of quickly go over what some of these probability distributions are. So probability distributions essentially assign a measure to possible outcomes or possible values of random variables. And the only real rules to this is that all these probabilities must be positive. Right, can have a negative probability. And the sum, or the integral, of all of the probabilities has to be 1. Right? And there are two distinct classes of distributions, discrete or continuous, and they're used to describe different kinds of data. So discrete probability distributions describe the distribution of data that are integer valued, right? So things like counts. So they'll take values like, they could take positive or negative integers, that the 0, 1, heads or tails, live or die sort of thing, that's a binary variable, that's a discrete variable. And so they have things called probability mass functions. And so for every value, it's got some probability associated with it. Okay, so these are three different probability mass functions. And I don't like the fact that they drew lines between them because there's no probability in between them. These are just point masses of probability. So the probability of 0 is 0.37 or something, 1 is similar, and so on. And that if you summed them all up, they'd sum up to 1. I think one example of this that we'll see later today is the Poisson distribution. So this describes unbounded counts, as in counts with no nominal upper limit. And that's what these pictures are, so are Poisson distributions with different means. So if your mean is 1, your distribution looks like that. 4, it looks like that, and so on. And it's just got one parameter that describes both the mean and the variance. And in fact, you can go in, when you're running these things, it's probably good to, when we start off, just clear all of our output here, just so that we're calculating everything new. All right, and so we can, so SciPy and NumPy have random number generators and stuff built into them. And so you can actually sample from Poisson distribution. And so we'll just give, say, a mean of 3, and we'll sample 1,000 of those. And we can see that the mean and the variance are pretty much the same. So as the mean gets larger, the variance gets larger, it kind of expands. Okay. Kind of looks like that. Similarly, SciPy, NumPy doesn't have this, but SciPy does. It has a whole bunch of relevant functions for each variable. And one is the PMF, the probability mass function. So here you give it certain values, and it'll tell you what those probabilities are. And notice that it looks very similar. The histogram of sampled values looks very similar to the PDF, and that's what we expect. Continuous random variables. So continuous random variables take numbers that are defined on the real line, although they can be restricted to a particular interval. So probabilities, for example, we said are restricted to be values between 0 and 1. You could model probabilities using a continuous random variable. It doesn't just take integer values. Or it could be defined completely on the real line from positive to negative infinity. And so continuous random variables, distributions have probability density functions. So these are densities. So you can't count them anymore. You can't sum them. You've got to integrate. One of the most famous distribution and most important distribution of all, of course, is the normal distribution. It's continuous. It's defined on the real line. And it's defined by two parameters, a mean, typically mu, and a standard deviation that describes how variable the data are. Okay. And I'm not going to go through all the distributions. I'm just picking one out of each. Same thing here, so I can take normal random variables with a mean of 10 and a standard deviation of 3, and if I simulate those, I can get those values back. Okay, looks like that. And then similarly, if I'm using the PDF in SciPy, I've got to create this sort of linear space between two sort of arbitrary values, and I can plot. You know, can't really do a PDF because we've got to discretize everything, but you can make a finely spaced grid here and calculate them that way. And as a reference, actually, in PIMC, there's one, if you don't feel like going out and buying a whole book of distributions, there's an appendix in the PIMC user guide that shows all of the variables that PIMC includes, and that's a huge number. It's like 42 or 43. It's all of the distributions you'll ever need and more than likely. And it gives you all of their functional forms, what their parameters are, and so on. So it's a good reference to have. Any questions about probability? That's like semester probability course condensed into how long? Yes?
How do you decide which probability you eventually are going to use?
Yeah, that's a good question. So that's the art, kind of the art to it. Sometimes there are technical reasons to pick distributions. Some choices of distributions make it easier to calculate that posterior distribution that's so elusive. Most of the time, though, it's picking a functional form that's flexible enough to model what your unknown thing could look like. Okay. So for example, if you know nothing about a particular value, say between 0 and 1, you could pick a uniform distribution that just says every value is equally likely. And that describes my uncertainty about it. You could know that, you know, the mean is going to be in this region somewhere over here. And so we're going to give it, you know, a normal distribution, and we're going to let it vary by X amount. For things like counts, again, Poissons are usually good because they model these sort of positive integer valued quantities. But sometimes those don't fit very well, so you want something with more parameters. And so it is a bit of an art, and it's just understanding which probability distributions you've got available to you and trying different ones and seeing if they work. See if your choice is sensitive, or your model is sensitive to the choices of the probability distributions. So you should all, it's part of model checking, is to see whether your results are sensitive to the choices you've made in your model. Any other questions? And, you know, I've never come across a situation where there hasn't been a distribution to describe what I needed. Sometimes you can modify things, you know, you can truncate distributions, you can customize things, you can truncate them or censor them if you need to. And PIMC makes it very easy to come up with novel distributions that aren't defined, predefined for you. All right, so we're fine, you know. I got to keep my eye on the clock anyway here. 40 minutes in, we're just now talking about Bayes formula. But it'll help us now that we've talked about probability a little bit. So remember that the goal, step two of being a Bayesian, is to calculate posterior distributions. So we're calculating these things, probability of theta, the unknowns given y, our data. And this expression is known, for those of you not familiar with probability, as a conditional probability statement, because it's the probability of theta conditional on y. And the mathematical or statistical definition of conditional probability is stated right here. The probability of B given A is simply the joint probability, that is, the probability of A and B, divided by the conditioning event, which in this case is the probability of A. And it's easier, perhaps, to look at this in terms of a Venn diagram, right? So if S is kind of our sampling frame here, our universe, and A is the event, this blue circle is the event A occurring, and B is the event B occurring, then A and B is this little slice in here. And so if we look at this definition, the probability of B given A is A and B, this little purple slice, divided by the probability of A, the blue circle. So it's just this divided by that. Okay. Notice that the other conditional probability you can get from this is similarly A given B, which is A and B divided by B. And you can actually rearrange these to both be statements about the joint probability of B and A. Okay. So you can make this just very, very easy math. B given A times A is equal to A given B times B. And that's just the joint probability expressed two different ways. And all you got to do is divide both sides by the probability of A. And you get this expression. That's Bayes' formula. That's it. That's the only estimating equation you ever use as a Bayesian. That's it. You're done. It's a little hard to perhaps figure out looking at things in terms of A and B, but let's go back to using theta and y. Now, this is an expression for our posterior probability. We call b theta, we call a y. And this posterior probability is simply the product of the probability of y given theta times theta divided by the probability of y. And these things all have names. Probability of theta, unconditional, is called a prior probability. It's called a prior probability because it's what we know about theta before we observed our data. And then here we have a thing called a likelihood. And the likelihood simply states what's the likelihood of our value of theta given that we've looked at this, collected this data. And then down here we have, I'm calling it here a normalizing constant, but there's a lot of complexity hidden in there. This normalizing constant is actually the numerator integrated over theta. If you put an integral here, d theta, that's actually the marginal distribution of y. It's the distribution of our data, which is a little bit unconditional distribution of our data, which is a little hard to get our head around sometimes. It turns out that it's the fault of this normalizing constant that you can't do Bayesian statistics very easily. Because, you know, if theta is just a scalar, if there's only one parameter in our model, we can do this on a piece of paper if you're a mathematician that can do integrals. Or if you've got Wolfram Alpha open up in your one of your, or you've got SymPy open up in Python, you can just do it, right? But when theta is vector valued, let's say there's 100 variables in theta, you can't do 100-dimensional integration very easily. And so that's what keeps us, that simple normalizing constant is what's kept people from doing Bayesian statistics, in a sense. Let's talk a little bit about the priors. So priors, Bayes kind of got a bad reputation for a time because of priors. They were derided as being subjective probability. So we don't care about that necessarily. But you know, you could sort of see, you know, if you're a cynic, you can say, well, who cares about your data? You can make your prior whatever you want. And because this is a function of this prior and your data, your posterior can be anything. You know, you could just make your study, your analysis, say whatever you want it to be by making your prior a particular thing. And that's perfectly true. You can. You can't hide it very well, though. You have to be very explicit about what you make your prior out to be. So saying that Bayes is subjective is a little bit of a red herring. All statistics is subjective, right? Okay. Even if you're a frequentist, which estimator, where did that estimator come? Did God give it to you? No, you came up with it. Why did you collect that data? You decided to. Okay. Every aspect of statistics is subjective. It's whether or not you're explicit about what you've done. So, but priors can also be very useful because often you want to interpret your study in the context of, say, all of the studies that have previously been done. So you can use your priors to actually incorporate prior information and then see how things change after you do your study. Or you can say, you know, what's done more often is just making the prior information very weak and then letting the data kind of override the priors. And that's what happens most of the time. The likelihood function is where all the information in Bayesian analysis comes from. And Bayesian analysis is essentially a matter of updating your prior beliefs using data, using objective information from the data. And the reason you can do that is because Bayesian inference subscribes to the likelihood principle, or it obeys the likelihood principle. And that is, the likelihood principle says that all the information about the unknowns, all the information about your unknowns contained in the data is summarized by the likelihood. The likelihood's all you need, okay? All the information that's relevant. And so so what does a likelihood function look like? A likelihood function looks exactly like your probability distribution or probability mass function, except you're just kind of looking at it backwards. And as an example, I'll choose the binomial distribution. So this is a binomial sampling distribution. This is when you take lots of these yes-no binary events, you know, number of kids with autism, number of people with diabetes, survival, those sorts of things. And it describes Y, the number of events, out of N trials with some parameter theta that describes how probable each event is. And so, you know, we can code this up in Python. So here's a binomial probability distribution here. So here's the combinatorial term. Here's P to the power Y. Here's 1 minus P to the power of N minus Y. And this function will return that probability of observing, in this case, 3 events out of 10, given a probability of 0.5. Here it is for 1 event out of 25 with a probability of 0.5. It's very unlikely, okay? And you can plot these just like we did above with the ones that are given to us in SciPy. That's a probability distribution. What about the likelihood function? Well, the likelihood function is exactly the same, except that now we're interested in holding our data constant and seeing how likely particular values of theta are. I've got this data. What's the most likely value that generated that data under this model? And so it looks exactly the same. I'm going to use the same function, except now I'm going to iterate over values of theta rather than values of y. And you can see that they're fundamentally different, right? This is a continuous random variable, right? Defined between 0 and 1. Up here, this is a discrete random variable defined between 0 and n. So the likelihood function is just the probability function. You're just holding a different thing constant and varying something else, and you're switching the argument around. That's all. And so I'll wrap up my intro to Bayes by just working a very simple example so that it makes this a little bit more concrete for everybody. And this is genetic probability. So I'm going to pick a very simple example. And it's simple, and I'm picking this one because you can do this without doing, you know, multidimensional integration. The reason is because there's going to be only one unknown, and it only takes two possible values. And here's the problem. The problem is this, that we have a woman. We're going to talk about an X-linked recessive trait. So something like hemophilia. So hemophilia is a recessive trait that's on the X chromosome. So so if you're a female, you can only be a carrier. So if you can only have one copy of this. If you have two, it's inviable. You don't even make it to birth. If you're a male, if you have one copy, if you're a male, you either have it or you don't. You've got one copy, and so a female can be a carrier, or So if a male has one gene, they're affected. A female with one gene are unaffected but carriers of the disease. Or you can have no copies. And so what we know about the woman is that her mother was a carrier. And the reason we know her mother was a carrier is that her brother is affected. And the woman marries somebody who is not a carrier. And so the unknown here is the woman a carrier or not? Our data is this. She has two sons, both unaffected. So if you're male, you've got to have both. It's a recessive gene, so you've got to have both copies in order to be affected. All right, so we can set this up. We're going to specify our full probability model. So here's the posterior that we're interested in. We're going to call W the state of the woman being a carrier or not. So we want to know what the probability that a woman is a carrier given that she's had one son and two sons that are not affected. And so, what's our prior information? Well, our prior information is genetics, right? We know that her mother was a carrier. So she's had a 50% chance of getting that her one copy of the gene. And so, if you like, the prior odds of this is just probability of W equals 1 over probability of W equals 0. It's just a prior odds of 1. What's the likelihood? Well, the form of it is this. What's the likelihood of W given that data? We can just calculate that, right? As the probability of observing the data given any value of the parameter. So what's the likelihood of W equals 1 given 0 and 0? Well, it's 0.5 times 0.5, right? There's a 50% chance from the first kid and a 50% chance from the second. So she could be a carrier. She got the wrong gene, or the right gene, as it turns out. The likelihood of W being 0, given both kids are unaffected, well, it's 1, right? That's the only possible outcome if she's not a carrier. She can only have unaffected kids. Okay. And so we just plug this back into Bayes' formula. So here's the likelihood of being a carrier given the data. Here's the prior of being a carrier. And then the denominator is just the sum of the two possible outcomes. So here's the likelihood W equals 1, likelihood W equals 0. And you just run these, and it's 0.2. So after observing two children that are unaffected, the posterior probability that she is a carrier is now 0.2. Used to be 0.5, now it's dropped to 0.2. And it's trivial to do this, but you can calculate all of this in Python. So here's the likelihood. And the posterior is just this calculation, likelihood times prior divided by likelihood times prior for both states. And we get the value that we want. One of the nice things about Bayes is that you can update your model given new information. So what we do, what about if she went and had a third unaffected son? Well, we can actually update that in place. And the way we do that is we make the posterior from our previous analysis the prior for the next one. So now our prior isn't 50-50, it's 20-80, right? So we can plug that right back in here. And then add a third unaffected child into this. And now the posterior probability is 0.11. And so it's dropped to 11%. If this individual had been affected, one, right? As soon as you observe somebody, a kid that's affected, a son that's affected, it's one. It's the only possible outcome. But as long as she keeps getting unaffected sons, but notice our belief is going down every time she gives birth to another unaffected son. That's how Bayes' formula works. Yes?
So the second example, you change the
I reassigned somewhere up here. Here I went prior equals post. So post up here is 0.2. I just made the posterior the prior now. And then I just turned the crank again. Yeah, it doesn't matter whether you do things serially or all at once. It's the same information. Because it obeys the likelihood principle, it's the same information. That's Bayes. That's all I'm going to teach you about Bayes today. Is that enough? It's more than enough, probably. If anybody needs to take a bathroom break, good. You can hop out and do that now. I'm going to keep on going, though. If there's no further questions, I'm going to get into now how you do some of this calculation. Things are going to start getting more interactive here if you're falling asleep, hopefully. So in that example, it was really I could have done that with a scrap of paper. And it was chosen deliberately because of that. But for most problems that we care about, we'll have to integrate over or sum over multiple parameters, multiple dimensions, making any analytic calculation pretty intractable. But so what we do, what folks have done over the years, is try different sort of approximations. Okay, so you can do analytic approximations, which we're not really going to talk about here. One of the approximations that tends to work, though, is to use numerical integration, right? If you can't do an integral, you can sometimes numerically integrate something, or you can simulate even better, right? So we might, even though we can't calculate a posterior distribution, we might be able to simulate from it. We know that we can do something called Monte Carlo integration, where if we're interested in this integral here, and this is an expected value of something. So the expected value of x is just x times the probability of x integrated over all possible values. And it turns out that if we can produce random vectors of x, independent samples from x, we can use those values to approximate that integral. And the more samples we take, the closer that integral estimate comes to its true value. So now if we have this integral here that we're interested in, h of x, h can be anything that we're interested in. Well, if we can use this finite sum, we collect h samples of that value. Well, we were given some theoretical backing to this. By the strong law of large numbers, sounds pretty convincing, right? Strong law of large numbers, I hat will converge to I with probability 1. Also, the amount of simulation error that you get can be shown to go down the more samples that you collect. And so a simple example here Oops, forgot to delete this. I switched it from beta to negative binomial. So let me just delete this bit. Just trying to introduce you to some more random variables as examples here. So distribution that describes discrete random a particular type of discrete random variable is the negative binomial distribution, and it looks like this. And it describes sort of the canonical description of it is that it's used to describe the number of Bernoulli trials, the number of coin flips that you need until R failures occur, or R heads or R tails occur. So how many flips of the coin do you need to get 10 heads, for example? And it looks like this, and it kind of takes this form. So here's this animated GIF that shows you, used to animate. It shows you what, there it is. Okay, so it's showing you for different values of R what this distribution looks like. So it can be used to model counts and things like that. More frequently, though, rather than silly coin flip examples, it's actually used to model over-dispersed counts. So I told you about the Poisson distribution that has the same mean and variance, and as the mean gets larger, the variance gets larger, and it's a very simple model because it's only got one parameter. It's very inflexible. Often what happens is that you count things up and it's actually more variable than would be expected under a Poisson model. And what the negative binomial does is it generalizes this. And the way it generalizes this is by essentially allowing that mean to change for every instance. It allows the mean to vary according to some distribution, in particular a gamma distribution. So it's like you take a draw from a gamma distribution to get the mean, and then you draw the mean from a Poisson conditional on that value. And so what I'm going to do here is I'm just going to pretend that, you know, we have no idea how to get at parameters of a negative binomial distribution, so I'm going to use simulation to get at them. And so what I'm going to do is simulate Poisson means. Oops. Sorry, this should be negative binomial. Oops, sorry, this should be gamma, excuse me. Gamma means. So what I'm going to do is draw n, in this case 100, means from a gamma distribution. And then I'm going to take those means and draw n Poissons, one for each of those means. And so I get, forgot to clear my output again. So what I'm going to do is estimate a negative binomial distribution with p equals 0.7, so that's the probability of an event, and then r equals 3. Okay. And so I can do that by simulating first from a gamma distribution with parameters r and p over 1 minus p. And then again, using those means to simulate from a Poisson. And it turns out the actual expected value of a negative binomial is actually PR divided by 1 minus P. And so we can compare values that we simulate versus the true value. So the true value is right about 7. Here it's a little bit higher than 7. And if we take bigger, this value is close to 7, but not super close. It's 7.6. If we do the same thing but take 100,000 samples rather than 100, we get something that's quite close to 7. So I didn't have to do this. We knew what a negative binomial, what its mean is based on its parameters. But for our posterior distribution of our big complicated model, we're not going to know that. But we can use, in some cases, simulation to be able to do this. Yes?
So, in calculating the posterior, the only integral, when we're talking about integral approximation, we're talking about approximating the probability of the data over all different values of the frame. That's the only integral.
Yeah, it depends on how you calculate. So one way is to calculate that normalizing constant underneath Bayes' formula, but a lot of the time you can sample from a posterior distribution and then renormalize it. So I'm just showing you that you can get at integrals that you can't calculate. In this case, we could have calculated it. It's a, you know, it's just a silly example. But the idea is that if you can draw, sometimes you can draw from the posterior distribution, even though you can't integrate stuff. But it turns out that even that is impossible sometimes. You can't, you write down your posterior distribution, but you can't sample directly from it. And that's often going to be the case. In general, it's not going to be the case. And so, and notice that this, you know, one of the conditions of this approach, of this Monte Carlo approach, is that we're able to get independent, identical draws from the posterior distribution, independent. And it's often not possible to do that. In general, it's not possible to do that. But what we can do sometimes is get dependent samples. And this is what allows us to apply Bayesian methods, or compute Bayesian posteriors generally. Dependent sample in particular that we're interested in is something called a Markov chain. So a Markov chain is a special kind of variable, a special kind of random process. The process we were simulating above, the independent samples, every value that gets sampled, every value that you populate your vector of simulated values from is independent of the previous one. Markov chain is a special type of stochastic process that has a particular type of dependency structure. And this is the Markovian dependency right here. The formula is a little small. It says that the probability of X, the next time you go to look at it, conditional on the current value of X and the last value of X and the one before that and the one before that, all the way back to the first one, is equal to the probability of X at the next time step conditional just on this value. So it's saying that the past is irrelevant. It's independent of the past up to the current value. So you can think of this Markovian property here as mild non-independence, or just mild dependence. That was a stupid thing to say. It's mild dependent, double negative. So you're almost independent, but not quite. Okay. It's dependent on this current value. And it turns out that if we can come up with a way of generating a Markov chain using Monte Carlo simulation, we can calculate posteriors of arbitrary models. Okay. So this is where Markov chain Monte Carlo comes from. Okay. You've probably all seen the words, probably why you're here. That's what it comes from, using Monte Carlo simulation not to generate independent samples, but to generate a Monte Carlo sample. And so in this kind of little inset, I've put in a justification of why it should work, because it becomes a little mysterious. I'm not going to go through all of this, because I think it would be tedious to do that. The one thing I'm going to highlight is that your Markov chain can't just be any Markov chain. It's got to be a particular Markov chain that satisfies something called the detailed balance equation, and that's this piece right here. It says that for a particular state of your Markov chain, so X, probability of X times the probability of moving to Y given X is equal to the probability of Y times the probability of moving to X from Y. And what it's essentially doing is it's balancing movement. So what we're going to end up wanting to do, this is our posterior distribution that's mysterious and something we can't calculate or sample from. We want to be able to, you know, draw samples from the posterior in a way that reflects its actual distribution. So we want to sample mostly from these big chunks where there's lots of support, but we also need to characterize the tails and this little middle piece in between. And so we need an algorithm that kind of moves over the support of the distribution and samples appropriately from each piece of it. That's what the detailed balance equation essentially describes. So if you can come up, so what we are guaranteed, right, from the theoreticians is that if you can come up with a Markov chain that follows the detailed balance equation, then the sample that it generates will be identical to an independent sample from your posterior distribution. It will be indistinguishable from an independent sample. It's a miracle, a Christmas miracle. Okay, that's all I'm going to talk about theory-wise. Any questions about that? How could there be? I didn't really describe it. Right. So we're just given some theoretical guarantees about this. And so all these MCMC methods that I'm going to talk about, what they have in common is that they've been shown to follow detailed balance. And so I'm going to go over a couple of the famous ones. And the first of these is something called Gibbs sampling. Probably the most, the world's most popular software for doing Bayesian analysis is still WinBugs, and the bugs in WinBugs stands for Bayesian analysis using Gibbs sampling. So this is sort of the granddaddy of them all, and it can be used to solve a lot of problems, and it's pretty straightforward to describe. So I'm going to go over it for you here, even though we probably won't be using it very much. What Gibbs sampling does is it draws conditional samples from the posterior distribution. Yes?
So we have a posterior and we don't know what it is.
Yep.
So we have a posterior and we don't know what it is, but what you're telling us is that if we can find a Markov chain for which our posterior is the limiting distribution, then we can sample from it because we can just sample from it.
Yeah. If you can come up with a transition function, okay. If you can come up with a transition function that obeys detailed balance. So each of these. So if I look at detailed balance here, this probability of y given x, probability of s given y is a transition function. It could be a transition matrix if we had like a limited number of states, and so the distribution of the pi's here are the distributions of the states, so the distributions of the parameters. And those eventually will become stationary, and they'll become stationary and homogeneous at the true posterior of that is pi here. Yeah?
So if there's a discrete set of outcomes that have a transition matrix, is there some simple way of thinking of properties of that matrix as related to detailed balance?
Yeah, it's irreducible, and there's a bunch of descriptive ergodic, irreducible, homogeneous. It does have a bunch of matrix properties, but it's more general than that. So what we're going to do with Gibbs sampling we're going to do some Monte Carlo. We're going to do some Markov chain Monte Carlo that's very explicit. We're going to sample every parameter in our model conditional on the values of all of the other parameters. And so what it requires is being able to write down your model in a conditional form and being able to sample from those conditional distributions. So the idea is that if you say you've got a model with 100 parameters, you may not be able to sample, even in a dependent way, from all 100 parameters at once, but you might be able to say, well, parameter one, given fixed values for all the others, is just binomial distribution. And parameter two, conditional on the values of all the others, is just a gamma distribution. And you can go through and simulate those iteratively. And so this is the algorithm here. It's very simple. You choose initial arbitrary starting values for all of your unknown parameters. So here we have theta as a vector, a k-dimensional vector. Initialize your counter. And then you draw theta one given the current values of all of the other parameters. And you stick that value that you drew from theta 1, put it back in there, and you draw theta 2 given your new value of theta 1 and all of the current values of the others. And then you take theta 2, put that back in there, and so on. And you repeat that all the way down to theta k where all the other values have been drawn. So this is very clearly a Markov chain, right? It's conditional on the current values of everything else. You're drawing a new value. So if you can write down these expressions from things that can be sampled, you can do Gibbs sampling. Okay. Here's a concrete example. We're going to code it up here in Python without using PyMC. This is a now famous example, I think. This is a data set of coal mining disasters in the UK. So from 1851 to 1962. So this array contains counts of the number of times there are accidents in coal mines. And Poisson distribution can be used to model things like that. Counts of, you know, more mundane applications, the number of cars passing an intersection during rush hour in every 10-minute interval, or the number of people using an ATM in a given period of time. Well, here it's the number of coal mine disasters. And what you'll notice if you plot these things is that they're pretty high at the early part of the time series, and then it kind of drops down at some point, some unknown point in the middle. And what we're going to try to do is model this as a mixture of two Poisson processes, one that models kind of the early period of the time series and one that models this later period. We're going to use Gibbs sampling to do that. So this is what the Poisson looks like. So here are Poisson samples from lambda equals 1, lambda equals 5, lambda equals 12, lambda equals 25. So you see, again, it gets wider because the mean and variance describe the same thing. And the way we're going to model this is as what's called a change point model. Okay? So as I said, we're chugging along at some mean rate of accidents, and then something happens. You know, maybe it was a policy decision, maybe it was some safety technology, and then it suddenly drops down and changes. Okay? But the interesting thing, so what we're going to have are two periods, one where you have an early rate before some time, we're going to call it tau, and then a later rate that's lower, more likely, after tau. And one of the nice things, as I said, about Bayes is that you can model anything that you don't know by adding it to your model and ascribing a probability distribution to it. Well, we don't know when that change point occurred. So what we're going to do, anytime you don't know something, just add it to the model. And so that's what we're going to do. We're going to make tau unknown. So not only do we have two different rates, we're going to also estimate when that rate changes. And we're going to let the data decide when that happened. So we're going to first specify our probability distributions. And what I'm going to use for the priors for the rates is a gamma distribution. And a gamma is a continuous random variable, a continuous positive random variable that is actually quite flexible. So this is a gamma distribution with parameters 1 and 10, 1 and 100, 10 and 10, 0 and 100. It can take all sorts of shapes. Okay, it can be a slope. It can be kind of a bellish curve like a normal. You can stretch it out. You can push most of its probability to one small area. It's very flexible. The more parameters you have, the more flexible it becomes. And this is a two-parameter distribution. And so we're going to use, as priors, gammas with parameters 1 and 10. So this guy right here. And so what we're saying is that we're reasonably confident that the value is going to be, of this rate parameter, is going to be, you know, less than 40. Right? There weren't more than 40 in any year, and it's pretty safe. Okay. And it's very, very pretty vague. It's not putting very much information at any particular point. Okay. And then for the change point, what we're going to use is a discrete uniform random variable. So a discrete uniform random variable assigns equal probability to each discrete point. In this case, between 1851 and 1962. Okay. So those are our priors. Got our priors. And our likelihood is a Poisson, right? So the data is going to be generated by a Poisson, where in the early period it's governed by lambda 1, in the late period it's governed by lambda 2, and where the late period switches over is governed by tau. So we've specified our full probability model. Gamma, gamma, discrete uniform, Poisson, done. Questions about that? As many as you want. Here we're going to say 1. But it's easy to do too. Yeah, you could just have a second tau that you could have tau 1 that goes between 1851. Jake?
know what the posterior on that is, but hey, it wasn't.
Somebody wanted to get out of this session, so pull the alarm! All right, does that mean we can keep going since it stopped?
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah,
you can bound, rather than bounding it between 1851 and 1962, you could bound it between 1851 and then tau 2. So you could use them as endpoints for each other. So it'd be pretty easy to do. But we're gonna stick to this simpler example with one change point. So how do we implement this in Gibbs sampling? Well, it takes a little bit of statistics, a little bit of math, but we can do it. So here's our posterior distribution here. Here's the likelihood, y given theta, lambda 1, lambda 2, and tau. And here are the priors. And so to employ Gibbs sampling, what we've got to do is factor things into a product of conditionals. And we can do that here. So here's the conditional likelihood of y for the early period. So it's conditional on lambda 1 and tau. And here's for the late period, probability of y given lambda 2 and tau. And it turns out that our priors are all independent of one another. And it's basically by inspection, right? The value of the early mean isn't dependent on what the value of the late mean is, and vice versa, nor are they dependent in any obvious way on where that change point is. They're just independent of one another. At least that's how we're going to model them. Okay? And so this is what this conditional distribution, factored posterior distribution looks like. And these end up being... the posterior for gamma for lambda 1 is a gamma with parameters, the sum of the y's before tau plus alpha, which is our prior, and then tau plus beta is the other parameter. So the priors were gamma, alpha, and beta, 1 and 10, I think I made them. The posterior is the sum of the y's plus alpha, tau plus beta. Similarly, for the second one, it's the sum of the y's after tau, and 1962 minus tau, so the other change point. So, and then for the change point itself, we're going to sample from a categorical distribution of this form. So you've got to notice you've got to do a little bit of mathematical wrangling here, and you've got to know a little bit about statistics, which makes the Gibbs sampler a little harder to implement generally, but it works. It's quite an efficient algorithm. Right? So I've been able to write down conditionals that I can sample for, just using NumPy and SciPy. There are already gamma random number generators. I'm going to make my own. Here's my own categorical random number generator here. I like how this can be done in NumPy. All I do is I take the probabilities.
May I have your attention, please? May I have your attention, please? An alarm has been sounded in the building. We are investigating it currently. There is no sign for an alarm. You can remain your business as usual. We will update you accordingly.
Thank you. So I'm going to take the probabilities of associated with each event, the categorical, and then you do the cumulative sum, and then you call the search sorted method, which essentially takes a value and puts it in its appropriate spot if you were to stick it inside that array. And it turns out you can use that to generate categorical random variables. The other thing we need is the gamma density. Again, I could have used SciPy's, but this is easy enough. This is the kernel of the gamma distribution. And I just built a little lambda function there for that. Here are our priors. And now I'm going to specify the number of iterations, I'm pre-allocating an array here to hold. It's going to be 3 times n iterations plus 1, because I got to put that initial value in there, because there's three unknowns here, lambda 1, lambda 2, and tau. So that's that. Next thing, we got to assign arbitrary values for model parameters. You can, make these anything you want. Got 60 here for some reason. I'll just reduce that to 6, 2, and 50. Okay. Literally doesn't matter what you set these to. It matters in the sense that you can be a little bit more efficient if you pick good ones, but they're meant to be arbitrary. And so here's our Gibbs sampler. All I'm going to do is loop over n iterations. I'm going to sample from the early mean. So this is just the implementation of the equation above. So it's an R gamma with summing the disasters up to tau I, or tau at the current iteration, plus alpha 1 over tau 1 plus beta, just as we showed above. Similarly, for the late mean, another gamma, just with different parameters. And then here's my sampled change point. It's an R categorical where the probability are this gamma kernel in here. That's this gamma kernel in here is just this function. So I'm just implementing this in code. You can inspect it yourself to make sure that I've done it correctly. Notice it doesn't matter what order I do this in. Okay, I could easily have sampled tau first and then used tau below. It doesn't matter what order you do them in, which is one of the nice things about this. And that's all we do. And so we run this. It's done. Now we can plot the trace and histogram from each of these things. So this is tau 1, or sorry, lambda 1. And this is the Markov chain that we've simulated. Okay. And you notice that it's hovering around a mean of around 2.5. If you take that chain and turn it into a histogram, that's what it looks like. That's the posterior, that's the marginal posterior of that variable. So that's the other cool thing about this. You get marginals for free. Okay. You don't have to do any marginalization. That's the marginal distribution of lambda 1. That's really nice. Marginal distribution of lambda, down here, lambda 2, notice it's smaller, okay, below 1. Here's the marginal posterior of the change point. It seems to indicate that it's around the 41st year of the time series. Okay. So 1892 or something like that. Yes?
So in this example, and in fact, all examples that I've seen of this type of analysis, there's a simple relationship between the observed data and something in the likelihood probability distribution. In this case, it counts that it's directly related to the solid distribution. How do you manage situations where there's the thing that you're observing, there's an extra layer of interaction variables and the variables that have statistical distribution. You may know an analytical expression for that, but it's not simple. Like, right. It's very complicated. How do you manage something like that?
So if I have time and I get to the end, the last thing I was going to do is show you like a real model, one that I've used for a publication that is much more complex. And this is where you get into building hierarchical models, and that's where Bayes becomes very flexible. And very natural to model complex systems. For example, let's say that in this, we can make this model more complex. We'll make the early mean a function of variables in the United Kingdom in every year, like the budget of the home department, whatever department's responsible for safety and mines. We'll make it a function of the wage of the mine laborer, all of these variables that could be at the level of individual miners, they could be at individual mines, excuse me, they could be time-specific variables. So what you could do is make that lambda a function of a bunch of things. And each of those things could be made functions of other things. And so you can add complexity simply by adding these layers that you're talking about here. Some of the simpler examples that you'll see in Gelman's book where you'll model test scores of children, not as independent, but as partially pooled quantities, where individual schools have covariates associated with them, but then also individual students will have their own covariates, and then states will have to which those schools belong will have its covariates, and so you can build this very layered. Model, but it's always going to be based on these sort of simple probabilistic building blocks.
I mean, I think, I'm not sure if I'm asking a different question. For example, the addressing that as a Bayesian problem requires you to be able to solve analytically for your normal distribution of errors in terms of the y equals mx plus b. But you have to solve for that analytically.
You don't have to solve it. You just have to write it down. Because we're going to sample.
What if your initial expression, you can't do that analytical solution? Maybe we can take this offline, but it's...
It's not parametric? What you're saying?
And this, I'm just trying to...
Because you can do non-parametric Bayes, which is way beyond today's short course, but you can, which ironically is actually infinitely parametric rather than being non-parametric. But that's a subject for another day. But you can do...
I'm still trying to figure out what precise property.
Remember, step one is you have to be able to write down your probability model.
Yeah.
Okay. So, and we'll do a linear regression example if we ever get to it. All right. We're going to do a linear regression, so maybe that'll give you some more ideas. Okay. Any questions about this? So, this is where Gibbs sampling did its magic. This is a Markov. This is a sample from a Markov chain that obeys the detailed balance. Therefore, this is an estimate of the true posterior distribution. And the longer I run it, the better it gets. It hopefully has converged. And we'll talk about convergence properties later. Okay. So Gibbs sampling is great when you can do it. But, it requires this. Okay, it's not very black boxy. We like black boxes, right? We don't want to have to do this every time. Most of us don't. And so it's good to have a more general way of doing MCMC. And this is provided by the next... major MCMC algorithm. So there is no such thing as MCMC, right? It's like saying bird. There's no such bird as a bird. It's just it's a meta class, if you like. Same with MCMC. These are specific instances of that with particular properties. And so, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, yeah. This is stochastic, so you'll get a different sample. Hopefully, the means will be similar. Hopefully. If not, run it again. So sometimes if...
I remember you changed it from 60.
Oh, I did change it. Yeah, I changed it from 60 to 6. Right. So you can sabotage yourself, right, and give these really bad values, right? Let's do something even worse. give it something really bad. It'll still converge. It'll just take longer to do that. Right. So initial value, I said initial values don't matter. Well, they don't matter until they do. You can make bad choices. Just like I say to my son.
You say you're going to talk about how to check convergence.
Tonight around dinner time, I think. So the next major category of MCMC, or kind of the main one, is the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm. So this one is better in the sense it's a little less efficient computationally than Gibbs, but the trade-off is that it's more general and it's very much a black box. And so in the sense that you don't have to know anything in particular about your model. When I say black box, people either think that's pejorative or compliment, but it depends on what you're talking about. In this case, it's a compliment. So what we're doing in Metropolis-Hastings is rather than having to specify conditional whatevers, what we're going to do is we're just going to say, forget about trying to sample from our posterior distribution. It's just too crazy, too hard, too intractable. What I'm going to do is I'm going to pick some other distribution that I can sample from and generate candidate values for theta. Okay? And then I'm going to have a procedure for checking that value and seeing whether I like it or not. Or the posterior will check whether it likes it or not. So you're going to generate a value, propose a value. Do I like it? Yes or no? If yes, I keep it. If no, throw it away. Generate another value, keep it, yes or no, etc. That's the idea behind Metropolis Hastings. And so Metropolis Hastings relies on having this acceptance ratio here. And so we have some way, some function Q that generates what we're calling here theta prime. And these are proposed values. Putting a little, it's a Barry Bonds home run record, provisional. And do we accept it or do we not accept it? And the way we test that is we compare the posterior, we evaluate the posterior at that new proposed value relative to its probability under the existing value, the last one that was accepted. And we're going to flip a coin or draw a random number between 0 and 1 in this case, and we're going to probabilistically accept that. And notice that the larger this gets, the closer to 1 this gets, the higher probability you have of accepting it. We're going to accept it with probability, the probability corresponding to that ratio. If it's 1, we accept it. Notice I put a minimum that and 1. It can't have a probability higher than 1. So if the new probability is higher, we're always going to accept it. If it's lower, we get to roll the dice and sometimes accept it and sometimes not. So ones that lower the probability will have some will end up being rejected some of the time. And so a single iteration of Metropolis Hastings is this. You sample theta prime from Q of theta prime given current value, and Q can be anything you want. Okay? Arbitrary. Then we generate our uniform random variate, and if it passes that test, we accept it. Otherwise, what we do is we make another copy of the existing value. We retain that value and use it as the sample from that iteration. The most common way of doing Metropolis Hastings is a so-called random walk. So the idea, so one of the problems that you might come to mind is that, well, you said Q can be anything, but how's that going to work out? If you make a bad choice, you could get really low probability proposals and just reject them all the time. How do we do this in general? How do you pick a good one for your particular model? Well, random Metropolis obviates the need for any of that, and what it does is, let's say here's our current value of theta, so theta I. Let's just do a one-parameter model for the moment. What you do is you just stick a symmetric distribution around that, like a normal distribution, and you draw a value from that normal distribution, let's say here, so this is theta prime, and if we like that value, if we accept it, we just do the same thing again. We put that same distribution over this, and we draw a value over here. Accept it or reject it. If I reject it, I keep this and do that again. So it doesn't matter what your model looks like. I can always put a symmetric distribution around the current value and draw from that. I could have used a normal here. If I wanted to be adventurous and get something with longer tails, I could pick like a T distribution that looks like that. I could even pick a uniform distribution over some chunk. Can be anything. We mean anything. When we say anything, we mean anything. And so all we're doing here is we're picking the current value of theta plus some little deviation.
Can you give us a little bit of intuition about what it means to accept or reject?
Yeah, so our alpha is going to be our posterior distribution under this proposed value divided by the posterior distribution over this value. There's also, you also have to add Q of theta prime over, or sorry, Q of theta over Q of theta prime. But if you use a symmetric distribution, it's going to be, you're using the same distribution to jump everywhere, and so that these end up being the same. So they drop out. So even though you can't sample from or integrate or do all these things with your posterior, you should always be able to calculate your posterior distribution. In fact, you are always able to. So you can always plug values in and calculate a posterior, always. And so you just evaluate it at that value. You evaluate it at your past value. You've stored that from the last time you did the calculation. And that'll be some positive value. That answer your question? OK. An important consideration here is how variable you make your proposal. If I put really big tails on it, if I make it really broad, it's going to take big jumps. And if I am very conservative and I just put a little thing like that, it's going to take little tiny jumps. And that will have implications on how well your model runs. All right, so here's linear regression example. Here it is. So I've got a trivial little example. Unless you're a real estate agent, then it's not trivial. It's a housing prices data set. So it's we're going to model is the price of a house as a function of its age. So here's age. I assume those are years. And then here are house prices, presumably in 1940s prices. I'm just dividing by 1,000 just to keep the scale down. So here's our linear model. So the mean, so we're modeling the expected price of the house as a linear function of age. But remember, this is a statistical model, right? Everything is not what you expect. There's noise. And in particular, there's more than just the age of the house that determines how much it costs, obviously. But we're gonna say that all of that variation is just white noise. We're gonna put a normal distribution around it. It may not be normal, right? You can get outliers. It doesn't have to be normal. Normal is just what we usually pick. Just like we choose alpha to be 0.05 when we do statistical tests. It's magic. But we're gonna keep it simple here. So here mu is the linear model, our sampling distribution is normal. And now all we have to do, because we're Bayesians, we've got to put priors on everything, right? So we're gonna keep our slope and our intercept, we're gonna make those normal distributions with standard deviation of 10,000. Pretty vague, right? And then tau, which is the here's another thing about Bayesians. They rather than, you know how you usually express normal distributions as parameters mean, mu, and standard deviation, sigma, Bayesians usually use tau, which is the precision. So tau is 1 over sigma squared. It's the precision rather than the variance. So how tight things are rather than how variable they are. And there's a couple reasons for doing that are a little bit computational. But they're the same. It's just a re-expression, reparameterization. So tau is going to be a gamma with parameters 0.001, 0.001. It turns out to be quite vague. Okay? Happy with that? So here's our data. And so all we got to do now, we don't have to worry about doing math and rearranging equations and identifying marginal posteriors that could be sampled from. All we got to do now is be able to calculate our posterior every time that we turn the crank on our MCMC. So all we need to do is calculate a posterior. So I got a function here that calculates the posterior of this model. And here it is. And what we're going to do is we're going to work in log posterior space. Okay, we're going to log transform everything. This avoids numerical underflow problems primarily and allows us to add and subtract things rather than multiply and divide. So we need a normal for the prior on A and B. So here's our normal with 10,000 standard deviation. Here's our prior on tau. That's our gamma distribution. We calculate mu. And then we calculate a normal likelihood given mu and tau. And we sum over all of them. So we want the sum of the log. So what we really want is the product of the posterior distribution. This is the sum of the log posterior. All right, so now, so that's that. Let me actually have to execute these, otherwise it won't work, right? And so now we need a metropolis algorithm. And so I went ahead and did this for you, so let's walk through it. It accepts as arguments and iterations, how long should I run this for, initial values of the parameters, and then a proposal variance, because we're gonna mess with that later. How variable is that proposal distribution? Okay, so number of parameters. Here's our initial proposal standard deviation. We're going to initialize a trace so that we're not growing arrays. You know how we don't like to do that in Python. set our initial values, set the log, calculate the log probability of the posterior under the initial values that we've arbitrarily passed. And then we initialize, we're going to count how often things are accepted or rejected. We want to know how efficient this algorithm is going to be. Now we iterate over n iterations, over n parameters. So for each of these three parameters, we've got to do this thing. We get the current value of that parameter. We propose a new one. So here is our random walk. Only thing I'm doing here is if I'm sampling, just making this a little more efficient, if I'm sampling from tau, which is our precision, this has to be positive. So I'm only going to sample positive values. And the way I'm going to do that is use the log transformation on it, inverse log transformation on it. So it's no point simulating negative values for the variance. Otherwise, I'm just sampling from a normal distribution which has the mean at the current parameter, which is this. And here's this proposal standard deviation. Then I insert that value. Now calculate the log posterior with the proposed value. Here's alpha. Now it's a difference rather than a quotient, right? Because it's in the log space. Sample a uniform random variate, accept it or reject it. If I accept it, put that new value in the array. Otherwise, I put the current value in the array. So trace I plus 1 becomes trace I. Got that? That's it. That's it. Metropolis Hastings. Done. So 10,000 iterations. We're going to arbitrarily populate the values of those parameters with 1. So the intercept is 1, the slope is 0, and the standard deviation is 1. And this is the standard deviation of our proposal. And we sample. Didn't say it was going to be fast. I just said it would work. And I gave away what's going to happen here. The acceptance rate is really too high. Well, why is it too high? Why is 97 sounds nice and high? Why is that too high? Well, let's plot them and see. Look at these. These are kind of ugly. What we're not getting here is a homogeneous stationary Markov chain, are we? There's nothing stationary about this. Remember how nice these guys looked up here? That's what we want them to look like. That's relatively homogeneous. What's happening here is I'm being way too conservative with my jumps. I put a really small proposal standard deviation on here. And so it's taking lots of little jumps that are almost always getting accepted. And it's kind of wandering around the parameter space. It will converge eventually. We're guaranteed that it will. It's just not going to do it very fast. Okay? And so we don't like these. It's, you know, highly autocorrelated, and that's no good. And so let's do the other way around. Now, rather than 0.001, I'm going to give a proposal variance of 10. So we're going to crank through that again. Done. Now, the acceptance rate is way too low, less than 1% for each of them. And what we get here is this sort of situation that's just shitty in a different way. So what's happening here is it's taking big jumps, but most of them are getting rejected, right? So here's what's happening here. It's at negative 0.21, and it's saying nope, for looks like 2,000 iterations, doesn't accept anything. Okay. So you get these long kind of flat lines. And both of these are examples of what's called poor mixing. You want that detailed balance equation to really be working well, and it's kind of mixing through the whole distribution. All right, so how do we do this? We have to tune things, as it turns out, just like in machine learning, right? You gotta pick these meta parameters that aren't even in your model, but are completely determining how the model turns out. So what we do is a little bit of an adaptive Metropolis algorithm. Okay, and so what we're going to do is we're going to modifier algorithm to look at the sample that it's just taken. And if it starts looking like this, it'll start shrinking that proposal standard deviation. And if it starts looking like this, it's going to grow it. Turns out somebody has calculated the optimal acceptance rate for the Metropolis-Hastings algorithm. It's 0.234. Easy to remember. That's optimal. So that's what we want. Something in, but anything in kind of the 20 to 50% range, you're probably golden. What kind of an error is it? You probably changed something accidentally. Ah, that's what it is. I'll look at it at the break. It sounds like you might have typed something in there. That. Aha. Yeah, these are all in Python 2, yeah. They probably shouldn't be. But. All right. We'll sort that out later. So this one's going to tune. So this is going to have a tune for argument, so it will stop tuning eventually. It turns out, actually, that tuning, well, it violates one of the properties that we assume in Metropolis-Hastings, that the, you know, your model's not changing underneath you. It's changing a little bit, but it's not going to affect inference. We can be sure of that. Where's our tuning? Here it is. So every 100 iterations, so I've got I give it a tune interval, and it'll look back over the last 100 iterations and check what that acceptance rate is. And if it's less than 0.2, it's going to jack up the proposal standard deviation, or sorry, it's going to reduce it, multiply it by 0.9. And if it's over 0.5, it's going to increase it. You're going to make it less conservative. Otherwise, it's the same algorithm. Yeah, so Metropolis.
There feels like there's a lot of tuning going on. I'm kind of surprised that you would get guaranteed convergence.
Yeah, well, if you ran it infinitely long, it would converge. You're not guaranteed when it will converge. You're just guaranteed that it will converge. Yeah. Yeah, Metropolis did the did this bit, and then Hastings generalized it so that Q didn't have to be a nice symmetric distribution. You could, you know. There are certain situations where you might want a skewed proposal. It's usually not worth the efficiency you're going to gain in having to monkey around with things, but you can do it. So, and now, look at things. There we go. 30%, 31%, 33%. Now we look at distributions, and, well, they're better, right? That one's good. Precision does really well. Probably just needed to run them a little longer, but that's pretty good. We're happy with those, more or less. And so you can do things. The nice thing is, what you can do now is, you can draw from. Once you have that model, you can simulate from it. So these are simulated draws of the regression line for that price-age relationship, and you can use that to quantify the uncertainty of your model. So every one of these is a draw at every iteration from the posterior distribution. I think I took 50 of them or something. 50. And you can see that, you know, here's a case where a normal error model might not be appropriate. Look at this guy up here. It's probably pulling that line up a little bit. So I probably would have done a robust regression and made it a T distribution or a Cauchy or something with bigger tails. Yeah. Well, the precision, in this case, the precision is modeling the variance in house prices, right? It's an estimate of the inverse variance of house prices. And that's a population parameter. That's not it's not a parameter of our model. It's the parameter of the system. So it's an unknown that we're interested in. You can calculate variances of variances. You can calculate variances of variances of variances. Even frequentists can do that. You can calculate a variance of anything as long as you have more than two estimates. Well, no, because so that variance, tau, will not change the more data we collect. Okay, if I collected values for every house in the United States, that would not change. That's not an epistemic quantity. Right? It's an aleatory quantity. So it's describing something that isn't reduced by gaining more information. It's an estimate of how variable house prices are. But the parameters describing the distribution of these posteriors, if I collected a million houses, all of these would be like a point, almost like a point mass at their true values under that model. So you'll reduce that. So one, it brings up a good point, though. One of the really, I said this at the beginning, but I haven't reinforced it. One of the nice things about Bayesian inference is that the outputs that you get are probability statements. You don't just get a point value that you have to calculate that get an estimator for a variance of or whatever else. You get an entire distribution, whether you want it or not. Okay, this is the output for the slope, that whole distribution. And so what can I do with this? I can get what the median of this is. I can get a probability interval. I can cut 2.5% off of each end and say, here's a 95% probability interval that actually means what people think it means. There's a 95% chance two values appear somewhere. I can get what the probability is less than -0.5, no problem. Do anything I want. Once you have that posterior calculated, you can get anything you need from this, and that's really nice. So it's almost break time. So what I'll do, so I'll leave you with this over the break and maybe a little bit into the time after the break. Here's your chance to build a model. So this is a really simple example from Gelman's book. This is a bioassay analysis, and it's simply outcomes from four groups of mice, each of which was given a dose of something nasty, and these are the deaths that occurred in each of the groups. And so each group received an increasing dose of whatever substance it was, and then these are the numbers that died. So the first group was given, this is on the log scale, so it's the log dose, -0.8, and none of them died. Give them -0.3, one of them 3 and 5. And so it's used to calculate things like the LD50, the lethal dose 50. How much does it take to kill 50%? So what we're going to do is build this model. So here's the probability model, right? So yi in each case are the number of dead mice, which is governed by the probability of an individual death. And the probability of death is modeled linearly here as a function of the dose. So logit p, logit transformation, and all that does is it moves things from the real line on into the probability space. So P, this thing X, is defined on the real line, whereas P is defined on the 0, 1. So it allows us to use a normal linear regression here, even though we're modeling stuff that's constrained between 0 and 1. Go. And take a break. I think is food out there now? Yeah.